welcome you all to Padmashri Dr. M.G. Rao Memorial Lecture.
It is indeed a moment of proud privilege and prestige for NAARM family to have amongst us Honorable Secretary Dear and Director General ICAR, Directors of IIMR, NRC Meet, Director NAARM, Joint Director NAARM, NAARM Faculty, Forecast Colleagues, Ladies and Gentlemen. I welcome you all on this auspicious occasion.
Now I request Joint Director ICAR NAARM to give welcome address.
The Honorable Distinguished Speaker of the today's Padmashri Dr. M.V. Rao Saab Memorial Lecture. Our Honorable Director General and also the Secretary there, Dr. Mohapatra Sir, the Honorable Director of the Institute, Dr. C.S. Srinivas Rao Garu, Mr. M. Srinivas Rao, son of Padmashri Dr. M.V. Rao Sir, Dr. P. Ramesh, the coordinator of the Focus, a very distinguished guest today's event, Dr. Praveen Rao Garu, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of PGTSAU, Dr. Ramarao Sir, the former Director of the NAARM, Dr. Nairu Sir, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Angrau, Dr. Jaina, Deputy Director General Fisheries, Dr. B. Venkateshwarlu, the former Honorable Vice Chancellor and now the member of the NAARM QRT, Dr. Padmaraju Sir, the Honorable, the former Honorable Vice Chancellor of Angrau, Dr. Siddiq Sir, the former Deputy Director General of the Crop Sciences of ICAR, Dr. Vayan Rao, the former head of the Agrophysics Department of IARI. All the honorable directors of the ICAR institutes and the heads of the centers at Hyderabad, all the FOCARs 135 professionals of the 108 FOCARs, and all the officers, the faculty members, the heads of the divisions, and the staff of NAARM. So I, on the behalf of the Director NAARM and the NAARM family, welcome the honorable Director General Sir, that he has given his precious time for all of us for this Dr. M.V. Rao Memorial Lecture. And I, on the behalf of the Director NAARM, also welcome the family of Padmashri Dr. M.V. Rao Sir. Now, may I request the Director NAARM to honor the Director General with a flower bouquet. I once again welcome all of you for this event. Thank you.
Now I request Dr. M. Srinivasa Rao, son of late Dr. M.V. Rao, to enlighten the gathering about Padmashri Dr. M.V. Rao.
Good morning, everybody. Just before I start my introductory remarks, we'll take a few minutes and put some flowers on my father's picture over there. I request people on the dais to join me. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, gentlemen on the dais, Dr. Mahapatra, Dr. Srinivas Rao, Dr. Soman, Dr. Ramesh, and distinguished scientists in the audience and the youngsters in the room today, all the budding scientists. To put things in quick context, this This is to introduce you all about Dr. M.V. Rao, who has been a doyen of Indian agriculture over the last 60 years. He has been contributing to Indian agriculture and the general nation building exercise towards generating food productivity as well as food security. In the audience today, I find people who have worked with Dr. Rao, who have been colleagues. I also find people in the audience who have heard of Dr. Rao. But I also see people in the audience who probably have neither met him, neither heard of him. So I think this is an occasion where people understand about the challenges which have gone through going in agriculture from the 1950s and 60s onwards, and the stellar work which has been done by scientists. This is to remind us the challenges which were faced, but also how we overcame those challenges. Every scientist, every person has been influenced very often by what they've encountered in their youth, the classrooms, the teachers, and Dr. M.V. Rao was also similar to that. He saw Indian agriculture moving from a situation of food deficit in the 1960s to a stage hardly a decade later to a country of food surplus. Today we can raise our head with pride in the among the nations of the world, talking of how India is a strong nation because we have a very strong agriculture. And the credit goes to scientists who have worked for many decades to bring us to the situation. So what I plan to do is, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Rao, what the work he's done. But at the same time, I'd like you all to take some lessons from some of the story of what's happened. So I have a couple of videos to play, and this will share with you all some of his achievements, but also what people have talked about, his peers have talked about. So the first video is...
Jeeva ke bahumulya 50 saal krishi ko samarpit kiye hai.
ये आप जैसे महान कृषि वैज्ञानिकों की कोशिश का नतीजा है कि हम दुनिया के सामने कृषि के क्षेत्र में स्वावलंबी होने का दम भरते हैं।
डॉक्टर एम वी राव, पिछले 53 साल से आप लगातार कृषि अनुसंधान और प्रबंधन के क्षेत्र में अमूल्य योगदान दे रहे हैं। 60 के दशक में जब देश अनाज के संकट से गुजर रहा था तो आपने अपने साथियों के साथ मिलकर हरित क्रांति की बुनियाद रखी। आपकी अथक मेहनत का ही नतीजा है कि 60 के दशक में जहां हम 12 मिलियन टन गेहूं पैदा करते थे, वहीं आज हम 80 मिलियन टन गेहूं पैदा कर रहे हैं। गेहूं की पैदावार में तो हम आत्मनिर्भर हो गए, लेकिन 80 के दौर में तिलहन की पैदावार हमारे लिए चुनौती बन गई। ये कहना गलत नहीं होगा कि देश में हरित क्रांति के साथ साथ आप पीली क्रांति के जनक रहे। आपने हमेशा इस बात को बड़ी शिद्दत से महसूस किया कि हमारे पास दुनिया भर में मौजूद खेती लायक जमीन का सिर्फ 3% हिस्सा है और हमें दुनिया की आबादी के 70% लोगों का पेट भरना है। आपके योगदान को देखते हुए आपको कृषि क्षेत्र में मिलने वाले सभी सम्मान सहित देश के प्रतिष्ठित सिविलियन सम्मान पद्मश्री से भी नवाजा गया। महान कृषि वैज्ञानिक और हरित क्रांति के नायक डॉक्टर एम वी राव, आपके तुल्य योगदान को हम समर्पित करते हैं महिंद्रा समृद्धि कृषि शिरोमणि सम्मान।
आई एम ग्रेटली ऑनर्ड टू रिसीव दिस लाइफटाइम अचीवमेंट अवार्ड। इफ द फार्मर इज हैप्पी, आई थिंक द होल कंट्री इज हैप्पी। एंड आई पर्सनली फील that like national security, you cannot take any risk with food security. You must have an agriculture continued progress, and I'm sure we'll achieve greater things in life and see that India doesn't go again with a begging bowl. And I'm sure leaders will be there always to lead the revolution. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Heard about Dr. Rao at the end of his career. We talked about lifetime achievement, but I think there's been a beginning for every success story. In the next video, is going to talk about some of his origin and some of how he's gone about achieving what he's been able to. This is a tribute to Dr. M.V. Rao. It was made after he passed away. He passed away 3 years ago, and I'm very humbled, and I appreciate the efforts of the various ICR institutes and IRI and agriculture universities in Andhra and Telangana, how they supported in maintaining the legacy of Dr. M.V. Rao. So the next video is a tribute to Dr. M.V. Rao. It's about 10 minutes long.
I come from a village background in Andhra Pradesh. I studied in Nasapur after high school. Then I went to Hindu College, Guntur, for doing my intermediate, and after that I came to Kakinada and I studied my BSc there. I stood second in the university, passed my first class. But when I was in BSc, my interest in the week came, and my teacher, Shiramurthy, he said, "It is India has a lot of famines so far. Nobody has found a solution to this, and if one of you can find a solution and control the wheat rust, you'll be doing the greatest service to the nation." That inspired me.
Dr. M.B. Rao ji, Dr. N.G.P. Rao ji, Dr. S. Ayappan ji, Sri S.K. Singh ji, Dr. M.P. Yadav ji, Dr. Ramesh Chand, Dr. R.B. Singh, Dr. Gurbachan Singh, Dr. E.S. Siddiq, bahut sare ati vishisht vyakti vishesh जो यहाँ उपस्थित है आज के सभागार में, वाइस चांसलर्स, विभिन्न संस्थान के निदेशक।
सो लाइक दैट आई हैड फॉर्चून ऑफ टॉकिंग विद सेवरल गुड पीपल एंड आई फेल्ट देयर इज रिवोल्यूशन, अ ग्रीन रिवोल्यूशन आर एवर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, इट इज ड्यू टू कोऑपरेशन ऑफ ऑल द साइंटिस्ट leaders, pathologists, entomologists, agronomists, forest and without their cooperation. More than that, this cooperation of the politicians to formulate the policies. And above all, the crores of Indian farmers who are the behind all these revolutions and collaborated in increased production of not only wheat and oilseeds, but all the crops of India.
It is extremely difficult to talk about the great and wonderful qualities of head and heart of my late friend and mentor, Dr. M.V. Rao, without going through a nostalgic memory of friendship over 60 years. When I first met Dr. Rao in the late 49-50, when he was working with Dr. B.P. Paul on wheat, he gave me advice which was very important for me at that stage in my professional growth. Whenever I had any doubt, I used to turn to him for knowledge, for counseling, and for above all guidance. This friendship and this relationship had persisted over the years until his death, and I can say without hesitation that in my whole life was enriched by my friendship with Dr. Rao and his family, wonderful family. He was not only a great scientist in wheat or in other crops, but when our country was very short of oil seeds, the then Prime Minister, Dr. Shri Rajiv Gandhi, turned to Dr. Rao and said, "Dr. Rao, you are now to take charge of the research and development of oil seeds and ensure that our country becomes self-sufficient." He accepted that challenge, and within a period of 4 to 5 years, we increased the oil seed production to such a degree that exports, imports, both of them are not necessary at all. And it was a great achievement. He introduced a mission mode approach, end-to-end approach, the way in which he transformed the economy of wheat, the economy of oil seeds, was to introduce a mission mode, which is now very popular, which involves attending to all ends of the spectrum, from sowing to consumption, in an integrated way. So Dr. Rao is known, of course, as a great wheat breeder, a leader of wheat research, director of wheat research, and one who transformed our wheat economy. But whatever assignment was given to him, like the one on pulses by Shri Rajiv Gandhi, he showed the same degree of capability, conviction, and commitment, which was characteristic of him. Well, we're all mortals, but some mortals become immortal by the footprints they leave. He is leaving his footprints on the sands of time, not only in agricultural research, but in agricultural policy, but also in his broad-based humanism. Although he was extremely busy with his official work, with his scientific work, with his extension work, with his lecturing work, but he never lost sight of the time which he has to give to the family, to his wonderful wife, son Vasu, and daughters. He always gave time and affection and enormous amount of conviction that the holistic life requires not only attention to one's official work, but also one's personal life and home. And therefore, his going away is a loss both to the family, both to the immediate family, and also the larger family who got attached to him. And I am one of them. I feel his loss, but I know they are all martyrs. But as I said earlier, some martyrs are able to live their footprints on sands of time, and that is one such is Dr. M.V. Rao. We all pray for his peace of his soul, and may God, Lord Venkateshwara, bless his family with the strength which is needed to bear this irreparable loss.
With the sad demise of Dr. M.V. Rao, a good heart has stopped beating, a good soul has ascended to heaven. Shashi and I convey our deepest condolences to Mrs. Rao, dear Vasu, and the entire family members. May our prayers help comfort you and give enough strength to bear this personal loss with fortitude. No words are enough to express our gratitude for Dr. Rao, who had made monumental contributions towards national food security. He would often derive great satisfaction by narrating the long journey of Green Revolution and his direct efforts as chief of the All Seed Mission, which culminated in Yellow Revolution.
So that was the life history of Dr. M.V. Rao. And I've never tired seeing his videos because it shows the story of a person from a small town in Andhra Pradesh and how he's inspired by the voice and teachings of his teacher in college. And he built his entire vision, his entire career based on that vision. So I think for a lot of the youngsters in this room also, you'll probably develop your own big, hairy, audacious goals, as they call it, and build your career based on a strong vision you inculcate in terms of how you address challenges facing Indian agriculture. It's very different from what it was in the 1960s and 70s, but it's probably far more encompassing, and a bigger role is expected from all of you. To quote what the first Prime Minister of India had said, he said, everything else can wait except agriculture. So in other words, national security, food security, is very difficult to maintain on an empty stomach. So the role of agriculture and the farmers is critical. So I'd like to thank Dr. Mohapatra, Dr. Srinivas Rao, Dr. Som, Dr. Ramesh, and the entire agricultural fraternity in Andhra Pradesh and in Telangana, even in the north, for the support they are giving in terms of continuing the legacy of Dr. M.V. Rao. And I think I'll leave the rest to Dr. Mohapatra to talk more about it. But thank you one and all for being here today.
Thank you, sir. It was really imperative to know about Padam Shri Dr. M.V. Rao, the visionary man.
Good morning, everybody, and Honorable Trilochan Mohapatraji, our Secretary DARE and DG ICAR, family members of Dr. M.V. Rao, particularly Dr. Srinivas Rao, his son, all family members. First of all, very, very happy to host Dr. M.V. Rao memorial lecture, and also this foundation, M.V. Rao Foundation lecture. And we are very thankful to Honorable DG for accepting invitation because of hectic schedules and the kind of love he has for Dr. M.V. Rao, and he accepted. And also, importantly, the another purpose is that to interact with the young scientists, 135 young scientists, perhaps linking with Dr. M.V. Rao memorial lecture and interactions with 135 ARS scientists is that through Dr. Life story of Dr. M.V. Rao, and also many mentors, many seniors, many great fathers of Indian agriculture, and like Professor Swaminathan, many others, Dr. Paroda, Dr. Chopra, through their life experiences, perhaps Honorable DG will motivate 135 scientists to serve the country. Thank you very much, sir, for taking your time out of that, and two dual purpose here, important things, sir, Dr. M.V. Rao memorial lecture, as well as interacting the young scientists. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was really inspiring to know about our Honorable Director General ICAR. The path of success and dedication to work is really inspiring for youngsters like us who are yet to begin our career, and we are stepping our world into the journey of ICAR.
Now I request Honorable Secretary, Dear and Director General ICAR to deliver Dr. M.V. Rao Memorial Lecture.
Very good morning to everybody present here. Dr. C.H. Srinivas Rao, Director, National Academy of Agriculture Research Management. Dr. M. Srinivas Rao, the worthy son of Dr. M.B. Rao. Dr. Som, Joint Director, NAARM. Dr. Ramesh, coordinator of 108 VUCAs. On this occasion, the primary objective is to deliver the Padmashri Dr. M.B. Rao Memorial Lecture. And at the outset, I would express my sincere gratitude to Dr. M. Srinivasa Rao and members of the Trust for inviting me to deliver this memorial lecture. And also thanks to Director NAARM for making this happen, combining the two events, meeting the youngsters, the future of the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, and also India's agriculture. Also, my sincere thanks to the family members of Dr. M.B. Rao, so who have come, his son-in-law coming from US to attend this. Gratitude to you for being present here. And this is to express our sentiments with regard to celebration of achievements of a personality called a phenomenon called Dr. M.B. Rao. And I am here to express my gratitude to him, about whom several accolades, achievements have been already placed before you, and I need not actually revisit them and re-describe them before you. But nevertheless, I have been asked to actually deliver this lecture, and I would certainly derive the content of my lecture from the life of Dr. M.B. Rao. When I was asked to link these two, that interact with youngsters and also deliver the memorial lecture, that is what I decided. The best thing which can be done is to amalgamate both, that life and the lessons. The life of Dr. M.B. Rao, the lessons learned for tomorrow, for building our own future. How do we do this? So certainly, this is my tribute to the departed personality, Dr. M.B. Rao, who eminently occupied the positions of repute in the country and also abroad, so immensely contributing to building a resurgent India, building a self-sufficient India, building a futuristic India, India which is resilient in the field of agriculture. And that is Dr. M.B. Rao. I'll have a few points about him while I describe what is that I would like to do. And when I was asked that what is that I'm going to speak, and Dr. Som was asking me slides, In fact, my colleagues prepared some slides, thinking that my background is biotechnology. And Dr. M.B. Rao also had interest in biotechnology, being part of forming the AP Netherlands Biotech Program while he was Vice Chancellor of Angrao. And also, I was also involved partly in that program. That is because of his invitation. So the slides were prepared, but I'm not going to speak about it. And those slides I didn't give to Dr. Soam for presentation. So this structured presentation I will not have. So I will talk about Dream to Destination. That could be the title of my lecture. From Perupalam, if I correctly pronounce his birthplace, to Purdue. How do we dream today to reach our destination that we dream today? And taking examples and achievements of Dr. Rao, M.B. Rao, during the course of my deliberation. Friends, life is transitory. Anybody taking birth on earth has to depart, and so also Dr. M.B. Rao. But one remains permanently imprinted in the memory, and the footprints are not erased at any point in time. The footprints, though they are, we say, on the sands, the winds don't erase them. They remain permanent imprints because they are there in the minds and hearts of everyone who worked with him yesterday, and who remained his students and colleagues, and also who continue to be inspired, the younger generations, and who would be inspiring the youngsters tomorrow. That is how a person of his kind is remembered and immortalized. So this is life, though it is transitory, but still immortality not necessarily confined to one person or personality, but certainly happens quite often because of the contributions individuals make, the footprints, the kind of footprints they leave behind, the kind of legacy, the rich legacy they leave behind, and which continue to inspire generations of people. Friends, when you talk of Dr. M.B. Rao, certainly, his years at the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, rather in the organization to start with as a researcher, that comes to my mind and everybody's mind. Srinivas Rao, Director Naam, was also discussing while we were in his chamber, and his worthy son, Dr. Srinivas Rao again, M. Srinivas Rao, was showing his pictures and then activities. And I was trying to imbibe, what is this personality? And as Professor Swaminathan also eminently described, the words, the humility, the vision, the conviction, several words that he was actually being contemporary, almost though he was a bit senior. So he was trying to describe his own experience with working with Dr. Rao and how they used to work to bring in Green Revolution. Friends, Dr. M.B. Rao is one personality who was associated with in different and various forms with Green Revolution and also with Yellow Revolution, the oilseed revolution. My younger colleagues may not know this. While we say Green Revolution and appreciate it because somebody else from USID coined this word phrase Green Revolution and described this, and we keep parroting Green Revolution even today, because the kind of ship-to-mouth life that we are leading in 50s and 60s, and Green Revolution making us self-sufficient because of largely wheat production, that we remember very vividly because of various people describing it so well, and also rice production increasing simultaneously, though it doesn't occupy that much of space as wheat revolution during the Green Revolution phase. Friends, the other day while I was delivering a lecture in India Habitat Center on Pulse Revolution, Dr. Paroda, who was chairing the session, he mentioned that we describe Green Revolution when wheat production increased from 11 million tons to about 18 million tons. There was a jump of 7 million tons. And this jump of 7 million tons happened because the strength of a dwarfing gene and dwarfed phenotypes and genotypes were realized by Professor Swaminathan, and it was intensely discussed. The genotypes, the seeds of those, they were procured, they were tested. Dr. M.B. Rao was a part of this. And so also Dr. Kohli and so many others who were associated with this program, they were tested, and rest is history, that huge quantity of seeds were procured and promoted. So Green Revolution happened because of the borrowed technology, the technology which was borrowed. The technology, the strength of wheat was realized. The associated management was defined by us. The main technology was though borrowed. The associated technologies with regard to management were defined. And that is how. And also, of course, the associated policies were put in place. And then we had realization of Green Revolution. So the jump of these 6 to 7 million tons, to be very precise, 7 million tons, that gave us self-sufficiency in largely wheat production and making us self-sufficient with regard to food and replacing ship-to-mouth life with that replaced by a life of self-respect and dignity. And this should be underlined. That is the time when India's sovereignty was endangered, primarily because India was not in a position to speak its mind. Speak her mind, rather. And arm twisting in various forms was happening that was not allowing India to stand tall. And today's context, if we compare and how far we have moved with regard to food production, close to 285 million tons, highest ever food grain production in the country, not only making us self-sufficient for decades, but also making us worry because of problem of plenty. From ship to mouth deficiency affecting hungry valleys and creating chaotic social situation to a situation of problem of plenty as we are today. And we are trying to find avenues to solve this problem of plenty. The problem, its dimension has changed. There is a concern of a different nature. The science-led agriculture has led us this far. And our predecessors laid the foundation of science-led agriculture. Thanks to Professor B.P. Pal in the post-independent India, Professor M.S. Swaminathan, and several others, including Dr. M.B. Rao, whose memorial lecture is being delivered today. And these stalwarts, they have shown us the path and how this can happen. Friends, while I was describing this problem of plenty, we were importing pulses and we're spending more than 10,000 crore rupees. 3 years ago, past 2 years, we have again produced plenty of pulses, moving from 15 to 16 million tons, today 24 million tons, 6 to 8 million tons more. And if you compare what we did in wheat in late 60s and early 70s, from 11 million tons to 18 million tons, and in the process we had green revolution, and someone outside the country describing you had green revolution. And today, in every forum I go, and in fact a structured presentation delivered on India's pulse revolution. From 15 to 16 million tons to 24 million tons during past 2.5 years and 3 years. This is the success story. The current generation of scientists very efficiently, effectively delivered and making farmers, in fact, in the process, harness benefits from this pulse revolution. What triggered this? That this never happened earlier. What triggered this is elaborate planning, a mission mode approach, as it happened with regard to oil seeds, and I'll come back to this point a little later. We created 150 seed hubs, and through these seed hubs, we produced adequate quantity of seeds. Seed replacement rate was the lowest, one of the lowest in case of pulses. Many states it was not even 10%. And seeds were not available. Quality seeds were not available. Enough quantity of seeds produced and delivered. Not just produced, but delivered. So this is the first driver of this change. And this fast driver of change, making us self-sufficient in pulses. The second driver of this change, this revolution that you see today, was the procurement policy. Procurement of adequate quantity of pulses and enhanced minimum support price. Which continues to happen. Every year it is increasing. So these are three main changes: that you have availability of seeds, that you have enhanced minimum support price, and also you have procurement adequately happening. That, in fact, encouraged the farmers to come up, grow pulses in increased area. Out of these 6 to 8 million tons that we produced, 3.5 to 4 million tons coming out of area expansion, and the rest about 2.5 to 4, depending on year-to-year variation, coming out of productivity enhancement. And this productivity enhancement coming from the seed replacement, the management practice, and so on and so forth, making this revolution happen. My dear colleagues and young minds, you would realize that 2015-16, when we started this, towards the end of, actually to the beginning of 16 rather, before March when you were planning to have this, the Kharif pulses and then Rabi pulses in 2016. While I was having a kind of animated discussion with higher-ups in the presence of a member of PMO, I'm not going to describe all those details, I said, sir, we are going to make this happen. And if it doesn't happen, I will resign. This was my word. And in fact, the kind of effort, the concerted effort, I must thank my Krishi Vigyan Kendras, I must thank all the universities, all were roped in and all worked in unison. It's a consortium approach, a concerted effort was put in place, and farmers also contributed immensely, and today we have a success story to describe. And my dear colleagues and friends, we have opened the export of pulses. You will not imagine that we are importing 2 years, 3 years before, and today we have a plan of action in place to export pulses. And we have difficulty because of already we had a lot of memorandum signed between countries to get pulses from outside. We have to honor those. So we are procuring because we have to honor those commitments. And when they are here, we have huge stock. And we have to dispense them. How do we dispense them? So there is elaborate planning taking place. How do we actually dispense them, disperse them off, so that we have newer procurements taking place, so that stocks are maintained adequately. And we are also trying to develop technologies so that adequately they are preserved, stored, without affecting the quality. And you know, the stored grain problems in case of pulses, a very serious problem. And we are resorting to techniques and technologies. And one such technology is use of processing mills and processing machines. And seed mill of Akola is now out of all the machines which have been evaluated, that turns out to be the best machine. And if you process this and store, there will be less of insects. So, and then also the kind of storage and chemicals we used to use to store these, they're also rediscovered, redesigned, and we are going full swing to have continued pulse revolution in this country. And so that the procurement happens, so that MSP is sustained, and also the technology interventions continues to play a very significant role in enhancing productivity of the pulses. So I describe this because the wheat revolution, which was associated very much during that time with the life of Professor Swaminathan and Professor Dr. M.B. Rao, and this phase, we have been closely associated to make pulse revolution happen. So I was trying to draw the parallel how things can happen. And they can still happen. The governments do bring in right kind of policies. And this is the credit goes to the present government for making this happen. So friends, when we talk of wheat revolution and the way we have progressed today, we have 98 million, close to 99 million tons of wheat production during 1917 and 18. That's the kind of wheat production today, starting from 11 million tons in 50, 51 or 52 in the 50s to 98 million tons, a huge jump that we have made. The other day I was discussing this, that in food grain production we have more than 5.5 times increase. With regard to milk production we have 9.5 times increase. With regard to fish production we have almost 14 times, 15 times increase. With regard to, in fact, egg production we have more than 47, 48 times increase. With regard to horticulture production we have almost 3 to 3.5 times increase if you take 91, 92 as the baseline. And in every sphere we have increased. In fact, pulse production we have enhanced now almost 4 times. And oilseed production, if you compare 50, 51, we have increased more than 5 times. So friends, in every sphere we have increased. But then, today we are doing crop planning, how much we must produce. What is that which is required for this country's consumption? What is that which is required for international trade so that we earn sufficient quantity of foreign exchange to meet the imports, the import bills, and also have import substitution? The present government has given a thrust for import substitution. There are many areas of our activity where imports are happening we'd like to substitute. But international trade doesn't allow to substitute all the imports. You can't just do this. But still, there are efforts, systematic efforts to substitute. But dear colleagues and friends, the kind of challenges that we have, sustaining this growth to meet the demands, the domestic demand, forget about international market demands. The meeting the domestic demands are going to be a serious challenge, serious, formidable challenges to all of us. And if you take the story of wheat, today we have the challenge of productivity. The productivity, if you see the Punjab productivity, is touching around 6 tons, 5.5 to 6 tons. But we have placed before us the targets of 10 tons. When I joined the council, and we used to have the meetings with the CG centers, and in this case, CIMET, which has been partnering with us since the Green Revolution days, and when Dr. M.B. Rao used to interact with the CIMET fellows, and particularly Dr. Borlaug, and plan it out elaborately how the Green Revolution can happen without realizing that Green Revolution can happen. And when they were planning that time, and today, our plans are in a different format. We are putting targets, giving targets to CIMET. First year of my joining, I said, our target is 8 tons per hectare. Nothing below 8 tons per hectare, I am going to accept any variety that material that you are going to give me. If I have to spend 6 to 8 crore per year and pay you, we keep giving money to international centers, the CG centers. I believe you understand what are the CG centers. If you don't understand, go back and read today. What are the CG centers and how do we operate with, along with CG centers? And annual grants we give them, and then through that we plan out what is that we want from them. And today our targets, first year I put the 8 tons per year. And I saw some sparks here and there. I raised the bar next year in 2017, and that became 9 tons per hectare. And that was communicated to DG CIMET. And during his visit, he discussed that how come every year you can change these targets. I said, we can do it together. If CIMET fails, my own colleagues can be there. In fact, they are there already in CIMET, and they are already working there. Let's join hands and then do it. And this year I have enhanced it to 10 tons per hectare. And they are worried that if you keep changing this goalpost, it will be difficult to reach there. I said we will reach there. And we have now lines which have more than 9 tons per hectare potential which have been identified. My dear colleagues and friends, that's the kind of pathway, the innovation pathway we are charting for future of Indian agriculture. And I gave these details in my B.P. Pal Memorial Lecture of IRI, the India's Agricultural Future, and 1 hour 45 minutes lecture. And it is there in YouTube and you can see that. What is that we want from these CG centers? And through our interaction, that is what we plan. Either you perform all perish and vanish from the scene of Indian agriculture. That's the kind of challenge I placed before the international community. And that is how our targets are. And that is how we are moving to meet the challenges in case of wheat. I'll not go to other crops what we are doing. And that is one example of science-led agriculture and targets based on science, not whims and fancies of an individual called T. Mohapatra. But because we have needs, but because we have an enormous target of doubling farmers' income. If you have to double the income of the Punjab farmer, the Vice Honorable Vice Chancellor of Punjab Agriculture University, Dr. B.S. Dillon, whom I respect, he comes back and tells me that Punjab farmers' income cannot be doubled. I said, why? He says that the yield ceiling is already there in case of wheat. We can't go beyond that. And if we can't go beyond that in case of rice and wheat, obviously, there is a natural ceiling and barrier to that. We can't increase and double the income of the farmers of Punjab. But I say that if I give you 10 tons rice, and we have now rice lines, Dr. Bulletti was here, they will tell me if it is correct or wrong. We have lines now in farmers' field at CRRI, they are giving 10 tons per hectare. And if you have those lines which are going to farmers' field in an elaborate way, probably will reach, if not 10, 8 to 9 tons per hectare. And if we get, this is paddy, not rice. In rice, in case of paddy, there's a different calculation. And in case of wheat, these lines which are giving more than 9 tons per hectare, obviously when they go to the farmers' field, we will have a big jump in productivity in farmers' field in Punjab, and certainly will be able to very significantly increase with crop-based farmers' income, particularly in rice-wheat system. And rice-wheat system needs diversification. That's another way of doubling farmers' income. Honorable Prime Minister's clarion call to double the farmers' income is possible. And this is one of the ways. Per unit area, per unit time, we have to enhance the productivity. We say, and always we cry, and my valued colleagues, many of my eminent colleagues also keep telling and deriding the efforts of Indian scientists that our productivity has not increased. I am doing a study and partly it is done, it's going to be published in Current Science. And the elaborate study I have done that what is the productivity of Indian crops with regard to per hectare and per unit time. And that this we forget when you compare the productivity of China and the US. And this is what my young colleagues must learn, that how do we compare appropriately. These appropriate comparisons we do not do in this country and always devalue ourselves. And we are responsible for most of the ills that ICAR is facing today because we have very insufficient understanding of what has happened and what is happening. And that's the reason why we deride our own strength and the process end up with a lot of problems and create problems for ICAR. And I'll not describe all those, but these are the facts. And so friends and colleagues and friends, so we must take pride in what we are doing in our profession. But you must not forget, when you take pride in profession, you must also learn how to take pride in perfection. While taking pride in profession, you must learn and must not forget how to take pride in perfection. And if we can inculcate this habit of taking pride in perfection, I believe this will be altogether different world. The agriculture scenario of this country will be different than what it is today. Friends, I was talking about wheat. Let me come back and complete this lecture, otherwise the whole day I'll spend here and talking about various issues. So in case of wheat, we have many challenges. The climate is changing. And the kind of diseases and new strains, they are coming up. Mind you, we were worried about UG99 strains of wheat rust. But because of our own strength and the way we planned our experiment, the way we utilized our germplasm resource, the science-based deployment of genes, strategic gene deployment that we did, so we managed wheat rust, including UG99, which was so devastating. Whole world was worried, but India was not, because India knew in the past how to manage wheat crop. Starting from Dr. B.P. Pal, multiple rust-resistant lines that he developed in 50s, that again inspires us even today, and that is how we were recognized with an award, Global Gene Stewardship Award, which I received from Borlaug Initiative, Global Borlaug Initiative, and that I went personally to receive this award in Morocco from the hands of the daughter of Dr. Normal Borlaug, who handed over this award to me. That Gene Stewardship Award, that was recognizing, that recognized our own work of systematic gene deployment to manage wheat rust disease. But my dear colleagues and friends, the new disease of wheat blast. We used to worry about rice blast disease. This disease is highly devastating. The blast genome is a kind of fluid genome. It rearranges very fast. It changes very fast. And in the process, makes all the resistant varieties susceptible within a very short period of time. The durable resistance is very difficult to have in case of blast disease in rice. And now you have this devastating disease in wheat called wheat blast. And how do you manage wheat blast? And our neighboring country, Bangladesh, is suffering from this wheat blast. They import largely wheat. Very little area they grow. And they can stop. In fact, the Honorable Agriculture Minister of Bangladesh emphasized that I don't have to worry because I import the whole thing. I can close down completely the wheat cultivation in this country and then prevent the disease spreading further and troubling my farmers. But India cannot afford that. India's food security is greatly dependent upon wheat production. And if wheat production is devastated by this devastating disease called wheat blast, then I will be in trouble, the whole country will be in trouble. And I have to again go with a begging bowl to countries which are producing enough quantity of wheat. But mind you, India's population is going to be 1.6 billion by 2050. And I cannot go with a begging bowl and get sufficient quantity to feed this huge population. I have to produce enough quantity, and that has to be my future. That has to be my pathway for future agriculture research. How do I, in fact, sustain the growth that has been attained today? And wheat blast has to be managed. The lines were sent outside. They have been evaluated. Now I have identified lines and genotypes which are resistant. And those genes are being pyramided in the high-yielding backgrounds. And I will be able to manage this. But in the border areas, elaborate surveillance is there in place. And the crops which are grown there, the susceptible variety, they are being burnt and in fact completely eliminated. And in the process, we have a system in place so that we develop more diagnostics to understand this. We must have evolution of this particular pathogen understood here in this country. And in the process, a lot of science to be done. But the newer races of rust pathogen which are emerging in Europe last year, there was, in fact, elaborate coverage in the press and media that Europe is frightened because of new races of the pathogen which are emerging with regard to wheat rust, and wheat crops are going to suffer heavily from this. But by way of placing these, in fact, evaluating, assessing the performance of all the germplasm of wheat that we have in our gene bank, and evaluating for all the relief diseases of wheat, we have actually identified this strength in our germplasm, which can be deployed to manage this in case of wheat. My dear colleagues and friends, Dr. M.B. Rao, while actually evaluating lines from CIMIT and also managing rust thereby using the genes and starting with Dr. B.P. Pal's time, so we could manage that time. The borrowed material were put to a lot of crossing, and we developed our own lines which were resistant to wheat rust. And today, we are managing, so certainly we are getting help from CIMIT, the International Center, CG Center, and which is providing germplasm and also helping us out. But at the same time, in different centers of All India Coordinated Trials, which was coordinated by none other than, to start with, Dr. M.B. Rao. He was the first coordinator of All India Coordinated Project, and he occupied that in the age of 43. Age of 43, that should inspire you. And when I said, I am going to present before you, dream to destination, and what kind of dreams you must have today that you reach that destination, and you must dream about a destination. And what is that he dreamt? From his own small village to, you know, university in US, and then coming back and then coordinating the whole wheat program. And also, during that phase of green revolution and getting involved with the wheat work very elaborately and giving us the green revolution in the process as a partner, as a very an eminent worker in the wheat field. And similarly, as we see in wheat that he contributed, and the way we have planned for future revolution and sustaining the growth and sustaining the gains that we have obtained in wheat, and also furthering and breaking the yield barriers and going beyond the ceilings, and that is what we are planning for another revolution in wheat. And taking cues, taking lessons from the leadership of those who have sown the path and sown the seeds in 60s and 70s, we are going forward and moving forward and setting again another examples of creating newer pathway of innovation so that the future generations of scientists prosper and also deliver, and also future brand of farmers are having profitable agriculture. That's what Honorable Prime Minister keeps talking about. The agriculture has to be profitable, and agriculture has to pay. If it doesn't pay, nobody will be there to do agriculture. My dear colleagues and friends, Honorable M.B. Rao's, another area of specialization and contribution was the technology mission on oil seeds. The technology mission on oil seeds, where he demonstrated that India can be also self-sufficient in oil seeds. We have actually, as I said, we have done tremendous progress in oilseed area. We have enhanced 5 times the oilseed production, but we have faltered somewhere. And my colleague, Dr. Reddy, tells me that our production, though increased 5 times, but we have serious problem with regard to consumption. Our consumption was around 11 kg per day before 2005. And today, in fact, somewhere around 9 to 10 kg per year, not day, kg, 9 to 10 per capita consumption, 9 to 10 kg or 11 kg, so before 2005. And that subsequently increased, and today we have 18 kg of oil consumption per year per individual. World Health Organization recommends that you must not consume more than 11 kg per year per person anyway. And also you must have a balanced oil consumption, that your saturated fatty acid, monounsaturated fatty acid, polyunsaturated fatty acid, they have to be, American Heart Association recommends, they have to be in the ratio of 1:1:1. That's the kind of oil we should consume. And that was the mission, technology mission on oil seeds. And that is what the credit goes to Dr. M.B. Rao. 3 to 4 years when he was actually leading that program, And in fact, his position was equated with a special secretary position of Government of India. And he spearheaded that, spearheaded again the same formula that seed availability has to be adequate. He moved all over the country and went from place to place, university to university, and then managed this very efficiently and leading to real near self-sufficiency in oil production, edible oil production that time. That was in 1990s. But we continued. There are few things which happened. I'm not going to describe all this, that we again faltered. Our consumption not only increased, but also our production and meeting the demands fall short of what was actually required. And we went on importing. Because of a policy decision we took, we went on importing, and import is today 60 to 70% of oil we are importing. And what is that we are importing? Most of it is palm oil. And what is this palm oil? 84-85% is saturated fatty acid. And we are allowed 2% blending, but you will find in the name of refined oil, vegetable oil, blending goes up to 60% and 70% with palm oil. We, without realizing what oil we are consuming, and consuming more than what is recommended. So that is how we are actually affecting, and we say health, malnutrition. But this is one area we have not actually created enough awareness among consumers that we are consuming unhealthy oil and huge quantity of unhealthy oil. Also describes this in some other format, but never mind. What is that is described is that we must have a balanced oil consumption and less of oil consumption, and to meet this huge requirement of the 2030, this is about 15 million tons that we are importing today. About 15 million tons we are importing today. And this has increased from 4 million tons in 2001 to 15 to 16 million tons in 2017-18. And in the process, spending more than 70,000 crore rupees, 75,000 crore rupees. 75,000 crore rupees. This is a serious challenge to all of us, my youngsters, that when Dr. M.B. Rao struggled and in fact put in place all the requirements to have self-sufficiency in oil seeds, and today I am importing so much of oil, more than 15 million tons of edible oil, and spending more than 75,000 crore rupees. And this is one area of serious concern for me at the ICAR. And now the government is planning and bringing in that kind of focus. And what we are spending in research and development? 400 crore rupees per year. 400 crore rupees. When I'm spending 75,000 crore rupees in import, the spending on research and development is just 400 to 500 crore rupees. So that's the kind of emphasis we need to change, that we must have investment in research and development, so that we have that kind of, in fact, programs in place, that kind of research in place, that kind of development activities in place, and that kind of support system in place, so that we are, in fact, in a position to meet this requirement of edible oil. Friends, I can keep on describing the areas with which Dr. M.B. Rao was associated. And he succeeded, and I said we succeeded in wheat subsequently and continue succeeding, but this is one area of serious concern and we are yet to succeed. And while discussing with Director Oilseeds, we are planning, and oil palm, again oil palm is another story, and I will not go into those details, it take quite a bit of time, it's already 12:30. And so instead of revisiting those again and again, so I would say that this is one area where we have to perform. Otherwise, we will be actually, the history will not actually pardon us. History will punish us if we don't really pass this test and come out successful with regard to edible oils. If not in 2 years, at least in 5 years, if not 5 years, at least you have to have a plan for 10 years where we can have sufficient production. And also our consumption has to be rationalized, and consumption has to be, you know, put in proper perspective so that the consumers understand what they are actually eating, and then automatically there will be a decline in requirements. Friends, Dr. M.B. Rao talked about not only he served, as an oilseed mission director, but also he was acting in many different places and spearheading many different activities. And in fact, one of these area was being at the university and bringing this AP Netherlands biotech program. And when he, in fact, engaged me in that particular program, invited me to be there, and I used to come those days to take part in those evaluation assessment, of projects and all that. So that time I realized that Dr. M.B. Rao was not just interested and understood the value of traditional breeding and crop improvement, but also he understood the strength of biotechnology, the frontier area of biology, and how that biology can deliver. By that time, when he was Vice Chancellor of Angrao, and that time he realized the strength of the genetic engineering. And subsequently, in fact, the kind of deliberations that we used to have, used to invite experts from outside and through this Netherlands and program and engage everybody. In fact, farmers were also invited to participate in deliberations and how we can promote biotech products those days. That's the kind of efforts he made. And not only that, the newer programs, for instance, the kind of insect resistance in castor, quality protein maize that was to be promoted here in Andhra Pradesh, to be built, to be transferred, the gene to be transferred in local varieties and hybrids, and then to be promoted. And many areas, drought tolerance, for instance, I delivered once a lecture, how to actually have drought tolerance and the QTLs and all that to be transferred to appropriate backgrounds in rice, for instance. So he had a very broad idea of biotech-based products, marker-assisted selection-based biotech products, and also genetically modified products to be promoted those days. And BT cotton today, as we stand, with a great deal of satisfaction, that's one product which has gone to field and immensely benefited farmers, and also immensely benefited the environment, the health of environment, the way the kind of decline that happened because of use of GM cotton, BT cotton, the pesticide consumption certainly declined. And we could manage cotton crops so effectively. Around 300 to 350 kg of lint per hectare, and we increase it to more than 550 kg lint per hectare. And today we are around 370 to 380 kg lint per hectare. So that's the kind of jump it made because of this technology, which he very strongly believed that it can actually serve the purpose and benefit the farmers immensely. But then, my dear colleagues and friends, that is where we are stagnating. For past 4 or 5 years, I was looking at the data, we are around 570-580 kg lint per hectare, and we are not going beyond, despite my colleagues from private, they may be present here. And this is a matter of serious concern. And you and me together, we should be able to breaking this ceiling. And what are the ways and pathways? Pathway of innovation I was talking about. And how do I make things happen so that I go beyond that? My colleagues at the Cotton Institute keep telling me that they have lines which can give us more than 1,000 kg. And some of them give 1,200 kg lint per hectare. And in ideal situation, they can give even 2,000 kg lint per hectare. But they are very rare. And going beyond 1,200, going beyond, in fact, 1,000 is very, very difficult. And how do I make this happen? And Dr. S.A. Patil tells me that when he was trying to develop these hybrids and making a cross between hirsutum and barbadens, without realizing what is there in store. And today, we say the Barbadans quality cotton, extra long staple cotton I need. But today, I don't have that. One old variety, Suvin, which is raining today, and I don't have new varieties of extra long staple cotton. I have to import. And similarly, breaking this yield ceiling is a serious challenge. How do I make this happen? Biotech, okay. What is that biotech can give me so that I can break this ceiling? And the management, high density planting, can I take it to farmers' field along with the management? The shorter duration crop varieties with high degree of potential, and also the peaking, just two peakings, not four peakings, and then managing through integrated pest management these insects, which are so devastating on cotton crop. And today, you know, all these pink bollworm and then many others which are there, which are playing havoc in case of cotton because of long duration and all that, can I really make a dent in this arena? My young colleagues who are sitting here, this is a challenge before us, and how do we make it? And remember, when Dr. M.B. Rao was pushing those projects and then making things happen, and today still we struggle, and we still continue struggling in this area and trying to find out new pathway of innovation that can help us actually build this, you know, kind of a cotton area and whole fiber crop area, and not only cotton, even jute and even flax. And flax gives very good linen. And we are importing whole thing, and we have an All India Coordinated Trial System in flax. But the productivity is so low, we have never bothered for fiber in case of flaxes. We have gone for, again, omega-3 fatty acid is rich there, and we have not been able to actually exploit and enhance farmers' income by way of capitalizing on the strength of flax today. So that's an elaborate kind of potential existing there, untapped potential in case of flax. And this country and farmers of this country would immensely benefit if we can actually promote this in the form of fiber crop as well as omega-3 rich oil crop, which can be actually utilized in various ways. So when Dr. M.B. Rao used to invite me and we used to have discussions on use of biotech, in fact, the conventional breeding and the strength of it is not yet fully exploited in cotton and also flax and crops like this, and even in case of jute. My dear colleagues and friends, so this is one area, the biotech area, and today it is expanding, the horizons are expanding so fast. Where we are? In fact, we are nowhere. These pathways which we should have defined 20 years ago, at least 10 years ago, we didn't do it. And somehow we have missed it. Somehow we have missed it. As researchers, we should have actually moved faster in this area. The whole world has moved in the direction of genome editing, and we are just starting. We are just starting. The whole world and even private companies, they are working on genomic selection in animals, thanks to Dr. Jena, who is actually spearheading genome selection in case of animal system. Though he's a fishery scientist, he is understands great deal of animal science and research. And just we had a workshop at IBRI to, in fact, have elaborate program on genomic selection in animal system. Animal system can pay great dividend. In fact, they can actually, our local breeds, we keep actually crying. Local breeds give only 1 kg, 2 kg, 5 kg of milk per day. And that's it. And, you know, always compare, because that's the habit we have developed. Always compare somewhere it is 30 kg and all that. And without realizing the strength of what we are doing. We have great strength in this 5 kg, my dear colleagues and friends. And if you have to increase this, we have to increase this sustainably. And how do I increase this sustainably? And what technology is the most appropriate to increase this milk production sustainably? And that is what we are planning. How do I use genomic selection in the same local breed, and through systematic crossing and selection process, I enhance the milk production and also make these strains resistant to many kind of adversities that we see with regard to climate change. And we have genotypes to actually tolerate that. And I believe we should be able to do that in years to come. And use of biotech, those days it was just crops, and today it has gone beyond. And genome editing in animals. The other day I was talking about the African swine fever in case of pigs. It has been done. And we in the country, we are still debating the GM. The world has moved beyond that. And today we debate whether the genetically gene edited organism would be placed in the same basket as GM, the genetically engineered ones. And how do I manage this? If I change a gene and mutate a particular gene and very specifically in a targeted fashion and change a nucleotide, whether it will be same as a foreign gene which is being transferred to an actual one particular individual. And there has to be a distinction. How do we do this? And the regulatory mechanisms are yet to be in place for gene-edited organisms. Gene-edited organism and the biosafety measures, we have not discussed there, whether that should be or that should not be. We still keep debating. And that is one area of concern. We have to address this as we go along. They are kind of challenges we are trying to address. They are not yet addressed completely, but we are trying to address how to advance the frontiers of biotechnology and harness the benefits of this branch of science and then benefit the farming community in this country. And that is our focus, and that is how we are actually moving forward. My dear colleagues and friends, I will not be able to cover all aspects as I did in my Dr. B.P. Pal Memorial Lecture, which was for 1 hour and 45 minutes. You can see all areas of agriculture is covered there, and where and how we are planning. And these are the areas which are actually pertinent in the context of life and achievement of and work of Dr. M.B. Rao, and that is what I am emphasizing on, and how we are actually trying to address. And my dear colleagues and friends, when we say that we have to address this, and all these problems, certainly, you have to have right kind of administration mixed with right kind of science, right kind of policy mixed with right kind of science. And Dr. M.B. Rao actually lived a life of all, and all put together. As a good scientist who did science, he also guided science. He was an administrator. He guided, as I said, oilseed technology mission on oilseeds. And also, he was also vice chancellor. And subsequently, he became a member of the council here. What is that council? The legislative council, I believe. So he became a member of that, and ultimately, and winning for all that he did, Padmashri, a civilian award of this country, the third best, rather fourth one, after Bharat Ratna, the third one. And that is remarkable. And how this was made, how this all that he could achieve in this lifetime, he could achieve because of his determination. So if I say, I have a dream, my youngsters, my young colleagues who are here, present here, you must have a dream. If you don't dream, you are dead. You must have a dream. But to realize that dream, you must have certain things to do. If you have a dream, you must have a destination. And if you have a destination defined, though loosely to start with in life, because you do not know when, which direction you will move, but you have to aspire to move up. Move up, not to become dizzy and then something else, a secretary. That's not the destination, ultimate destination. I never thought in my life that I will become dizzy. I never applied. So that's not the kind of objective of life. So you must have a destination. And you must know where you like to move, what you like to do. So that's the destination. And to reach that destination, you must have determination. And that's what he had. You must have determination to go there, to realize your dream that you have today. And dream must be based on certain facts. And what is that you must be? You must be disciplined. If you are not disciplined, you will not have determination. Even if you have a dream, you will not have a destination. And if you don't have discipline, you cannot chart the course And the course has to be defined. These are all deeds. That course has to be the course that you like to chart to reach the destination has to be defined. And if you don't define that, you will never reach there. What is that you'll have determination to do? You have to move in that particular path that you chart, you delineate. That's another D. If you don't have power of delineation and delegation, that's what Dr. M.B. Rao was very good at. You have to also delegate. If you are at the top, you must, and you have reached the destination or close to your destination, you must know how to delegate. So delegation is another component of your success. From dream to destination. So what is the pathway? If you want to dream today and you define your destination, then you have to chart a course, and this course has to be defined very well. You must be delineating your path, defining it accurately, and then with a great deal of determination, you have to move there in that path and with sufficient discipline. And if you have that, I'm sure you will reach your destination. Friends, dedication would be very, very essential. It would be an essential component of this. If you don't have dedication to the very principle that you have defined, to very destination that you have defined, and the duty that you must have in your life that you have actually defined, so you will fail. So dedication to the cause, dedication to your duty, to your assigned job, would be another ingredient of your success. So dream to destination would encompass your definition of your chart, charting your path and delineating it appropriately, defining it appropriately, and also having determination, dedication, and discipline to reach there. And that's what you see in the life of people like Dr. M.B. Rao and Dr. Swaminathan, the living legend, who actually in all his actions and words reflects all these very elaborately. These manifestations you see today in their lives, during their lifetime, and also beyond, that should inspire us. That should build our path. That should help us define our destinations, where we should go. We should not be targetless, aimless. Do something and let something, anything happen. After completing this course, let me go to my hometown and then live a life. You must live a life of satisfaction. What Professor Swaminathan was talking about to Dr. M.B. Rao, that he knew how to balance life between work and family, and balance also have a very satisfying family life, and so on and so forth, he was mentioning. And that should not happen at the sacrifice of your family or personal life and all that. I don't say that. If you do that, that's up to you to do it. But what is important is that if you do not aspire, obviously you would not reach there. In fact, our ex-president Abdul Kalam once said that it is the dream during daytime that you have, that must not allow you to sleep, but not the dream during your sleep. That's more relevant and important. I hope you remember this, otherwise you go back and see this. That is what so emphatically he said, the dream that you see during daytime, when you are not in sleep, that is more important for you. And that dream will give you the path that you want to chart in your life. My dear young colleagues, the time is now gone and we have deliberated enough, and this memorial lecture should be remembered for dream to destination. And this memorial lecture should be revisited to define our path in our own life, my youngster friends, young colleagues, that you would like to have in your lifetime, so that you are something tomorrow to be reflected upon, to be remembered, to be recounted, to be listed during the course of discussion and deliberation. That happens 50 years, 60 years down the line. I believe by that time you will have completed your work, and someone sitting here will be calling you and taking your names and remembering you for your contribution. And you will be present there in the hall to be honored, to be felicitated. And can I be one of those? That's the question you should go back and remember this dream to destination lecture in that context. What is that I would like to become? Being and becoming is the principle of life. For me, the dharma, so-called, is the principles of being and becoming. What is being? Being is existence. I exist today, and I must have growth to become. What I should become? Not something in terms of position, but something as a individual to be remembered. And for what I will be counted and remembered? And that has to be actually discussed, deliberated by me. Nobody else will do that. So you have these minds. These minds are exalted. These minds of today, my colleagues, young colleagues and young minds, they are excited minds. They are exalted minds. They are ignited minds. And these exalted, excited, ignited minds and inspired minds, I believe, can not only lead us individually to salvation, but also provide new pathways of innovations, but also provide solutions to the problems that we encounter today and the problems which we are going to encounter tomorrow in the field of agriculture and allied sector. You are going to be the solution provider of tomorrow. Maybe starting from tomorrow, when you go out of this institution and work in your respective area, I believe you are going to be solution provider. Can I be part of solution, not part of problem? Can I be the part of solution, not part of the problem? When I become part of solution, then I grow as an individual. I become a solution provider, not a problem creator. I will have n number of individual personal problems. Those I will resolve at my own level. But I will work for the institution to build it. I will work for institutions to contribute for solving the problems of farmers, problems of this country, you know, wherever field you are. So that is the kind of expectation I have from you. That's the kind of expectation I have from you. And I'm sure the kind of hidden potential that you have, you can unleash that. Swami Vivekananda used to say that. Your potential is so latent in you, so suppressed in you, so hidden in you, they are not expressing, they are not manifesting adequately. But you can do that by systematic practice of discipline, that you can demonstrate that manifestation of your potential. Elaborately, you can manifest that and conquer the whole universe. You become the center of attraction, as Swami Vivekananda was. Through your words and also through your deeds. The problem arises because there is a great deal of a dichotomy between the words and deeds. And the congruence, the correspondence between words and deeds will happen when our motor and sensory nerves are coordinated. The motor and sensory nerves are coordinated. My dear young colleagues, try to do that. Once you do that, then you can unleash this latent potential which is hidden in you elaborately. Let the world go anywhere. Let the world do anything they wish to. I have this dream for my country, for my world, for my family, or a bigger goal, not a small, narrow personal goal that I set for me. And I have that goal, that bigger goal, I have to reach there. And for that, I have to unleash this latent potential in me, and I have to go for sensor motor coordination. And when I do that, that will be enough manifestation of this potential which is there hidden in me. And my young colleagues, when you are setting out your journey in the science field, it's a field of agriculture science, I believe you will be able to succeed, and eminently succeed, and succeed in a way that you become immortal. And on the sands that you set your foot, that sand, your footprint becomes, you know, immortal, unerasable, and I'm sure you'll be able to do that. And I'm sure the kind of inspiration that you receive, and this inspiration has to come from first within. You have to be self-inspired. The inspiration that comes from outside is transitory. If you are not connected continuously with the source, this inspiration will be transitory. It will be temporary. But if you are self-inspired, if that inspiration comes from inside, then you will be always exalted personality, and you will be able to inspire a whole lot of people who are around, surrounding you. And then you become iconic. You become icon. Icon of youth of this country. Icon of everything, whatever you do, scientists of this country, administrator of this country, and you stand out. I wish that you stand out in your life. That's the wish I have for you in this lecture. So stay happy, stay blessed. Wish you all the very best, young minds, young friends. And thanks to all my seniors, colleagues, and guides, and path providers, and all that who are sitting here in the front row, senior colleagues. And thanks to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We 108 forecast trainees are blessed to listen to your words of wisdom and vision. We take the challenges before us and promise for pride in perfection. The tale of dream to destination will always inspire us towards a defined path to success in our service of agriculture and India. We pledge for dedication, discipline, and determination in our journey of ICAR.
Now I request Honorable Director ICAR-NAARM to felicitate Honorable Secretary Dair and Director General ICAR.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. M. Srinivasa Rao to felicitate Honorable Secretary Dair and Director General ICAR.
Now I request Dr. M. Srinivasa Rao, sir, to felicitate Honorable Director ICAR-NAARM. Now I invite course director 104th focus, Dr. P. Ramesh sir, to deliver word of thanks.
Respected dignitaries on and off the campus, it is my proud privilege to give a vote of thanks. First, I would like to thank profusely Dr. Trilochan Mohapatra ji, DGICR Secretary Dare, for his a thought-provoking, highly inspiring speech, which coincides with Dr. M. E. Rao Memorial Lecture. Just I want to take two lines, M. E. Rao Memorial Lecture. He gave in the how he revolutionized the Indian agriculture, his contribution to green revolution, particularly yellow revolution, and how he can inspire the young generation. That is one point. The second aspect which I really like, and as a coordinator, I want a young 135 scientist to take home this message, dream to destination, very beautifully articulated, how you can dream, and how your dream can reach a destination, but with a condition that you have to discipline. Discipline and with determination. Definitely, sir, I hope that when Dr. Amira, who born a few decades back in a small village without much scientific facilities and all that, if he can become so great, why not our 135 scientists with all modern technology, all education, all physical and so many facilities, now ICAR giving the best organizational environment, lot of funds and all, why not they become 135 Amiras? Definitely, I really hope as a coordinator, they can do that. I hope that they stand there. And sir, I would like to thank profusely Dr. M. Srinivas Rao Garu. Actually, I really very happy that it is coincided with Dr. M. E. Rao Memorial Lecture. And perhaps most of the young generation may not be aware of sir, Dr. M. E. Rao. It is eye-opening that how a legacy of agriculture connecting M. E. Rao is a role model for us. A man who born in a small village can become a international reputed scientist. You can see in the tributes are video films are excellent. Excellent. And actually he given a good facet of the entire his life and his contributions on how he changed the entire topography of Indian agriculture, particularly in oilseed productions. So to make it brief, I profusely thank all the dignitaries, all the vice chancellors, all the directors of the local institutes, and all Dr. Siddiqui, Dr. DDG, and the representatives of all the ICAR local institutes. The successful functioning of this organization, particularly Dr. Srinivas Rao Garu, the director and the joint director, who makes see that every effort to see this function go well with tune that with Dr. M. E. Rao Memorial Lecture, and also inspiring the young 135 scientists. This is a very good occasion that we learn. This is a take-home message for learners. And last but not least, I thanks all the people who directly or indirectly contributed to the success of this function. I thank you once again for all that. Thank you, sir.